या गुड आफ्टरनून हमारे बल
यस
लेट मी शेयर माय स्क्रीन गुड आफ्टरनून लेट मी स्टार्ट विथ द सिलेबस सो एजेंडा ऑफ दिस क्लास इज सो फर्स्ट वील डिस्कस वाई डू वी नीड सिस्टम सॉफ्टवेयर सो वाई द सिस्टम सॉफ्टवेयर इज रिक्वायर्ड एंड देन द ब्रॉड डेफिनेशन ऑफ द सिस्टम सॉफ्टवेयर एंड देन सिस्टम सॉफ्टवेयर फॉर प्रोग्राम डेवलपमेंट एंड एग्जीक्यूशन ओके सो देयर विल सी the various stages during the program development and execution where the system software can be used okay. And then the next is system software and machine architecture okay. So here we'll see the machine dependent system software and the machine independent system software that means how the system software and the machine architecture are related okay. The relationship between system software and machine architecture and then we'll see the machine independent system software and then the differences between system software and application software and then we'll start with the simplified instructional computer so it is a hypothetical computer okay so that is used as a test bed for implementing the various types of the system software so first why do we need a system software So what are the issues when computer work without the system software? Okay. That means imagine a computer without system software. Okay. Then early computers have only application software and hardware okay. without the system software. Okay. So to give me an example, the ENIAC. Okay. So ENIAC, Electronic Numerical Integrator Computer. Okay. So it was developed in 1946 okay yeah so the earlier computer works this way okay. that means without the system software okay so in earlier computers all programs would be done in the machine code okay and here the application software would directly use that means these early computers okay in these early computers application software would directly use the network resources such as the input output devices and physical memory so they are directly utilizing these application software okay so without the involvement of the system software okay. what is the disadvantage here so programmers spent time okay on the program preparation and translation only that means much of the programmers time would be spent on relatively the clerical problems of program preparation and the translation so which is a tedious task okay a time consuming task okay and people started thinking of effective ways of utilizing the hardware or the use of the hardware and then this led to the development or invention of software called the system software okay so this led to the inventing the effective ways to use the hardware so that is known as the system software. Okay, so the system software exists to relieve programmers of these jobs, freeing their more time for more productive tasks. Or more productive activities. So if you observe the diagram here, okay, so figuratively speaking, an application software, so this is the application software which sits on top of the system software, so which is usually nothing but an operating system. Okay, so without the operating system, okay, so we are unable to run the computer system, isn't it? So an application software sits on top of the system software because it is unable to run without the OS. So that is, it runs on top of the operating system. Okay, so this application software runs on top of the operating system, okay, which is a system software, okay, and which perform a number of tasks of the computer, that means the operating system. Okay, so operating system here is the system software. Okay, so that is how the system software acts as an interface between the hardware and the application software. Okay, so what is the broad definition of this system software? Okay, so as you know that the software is simply a set of instructions or programs written to carry out certain tasks on the digital computer. And we have the two major categories of software, which are system software and the application software. So then what is system software? System software consists of a variety of programs that support the operation of computer, and system software is intended to support the operation and use of the computer itself. And system software in a computer allows to develop the application programs. Okay, and the typical system software includes operating system, assemblers, linkers, loaders, compilers, debuggers, and the text editor. Okay, so to summarize, the system software is a collection of programs. Collection of programs are nothing but assemblers, linkers, loaders, compilers, and so on. So it is a collection of programs which are needed in creation, preparation, and execution of the application programs. So a system software in a computer allows to develop the application software or application programs. Okay. Then what is application software? So application software are nothing but programs that enable end user to perform the specific task. That means application software are programs that enable end user to perform specific productive tasks. There is a software used to create things such as word processors, spreadsheets, your paint program, web browser, Adobe Photoshop, okay, and so on. So there is application software, the software that interacts with the end user, okay, and basically does whatever the end user is working on. Like, for example, as I said, word processor, okay, spreadsheet, your database, okay. So any doubts? Let us know through
no.
a diagram that illustrate the stages during the program development and execution where the system software can be used. Okay, what are these stages? Okay, so first, what we'll do while writing a program, we'll write a program on paper. Okay, and after writing it on paper, what we'll do, we'll translate that program into the computer. That means we'll use the text editor, okay, to create program and to modify the program and store the program in the disk and in memory. So we'll write a program and modify it using the text editor. Okay, so after completing writing the program, what we'll do, okay, so we'll translate the source program written in particular programming language, okay, using the translator. Okay, so translator is nothing but your this one. Okay, system software. Okay, so what is the job of the translator? So translate into machine language. Okay, zero or ones. Okay, so it will translate the program into machine language. So example is compiler or assembler. Okay, and then once it is translated into the machine language, okay, so it is fed into the linker. Okay, so what the linker will do? So you might have divided your large program into a number of smaller sub programs, okay, called modules, and each module can individually be written, tested and debugged actually. So when all the modules work, they can be linked together to form a single program. Okay, so how do you combine all these small programs to form a single program? That is using the linker. Okay, so the linker links the other programs, okay, sub programs, okay, or other object modules or object files. Okay, so linker links the other programs or object modules. Okay, and then output of the linker is fed to the loader. So what is the job of the loader? Again, loader is a program that loads the executable program into memory for execution. It loads the machine code of a program into system memory. Okay, so then after loader, okay, so you can run or execute your program. Okay, then the program is running. How do you test it? Okay, so while running the program, you can use the debugger, the debugger tools. Again, debugger is a program that helps to detect any errors in your programs. Okay, so now testator is a system software, translator is a system software, so linker is a system software, loader is a system software, and debugger is a system software. Okay, so what do you mean by editor? Editor is a program which permits programmers to enter, modify and store a source program. And some examples of editors are, you have the DOS editor, DOS edit, you have the notepad, okay, you have the wordpad, and so on. Okay, and translator, so is a system software, a program that converts the statements in one language into statement into another language. And some examples of translators are compilers, assemblers, interpreters, and so on. Okay, and then what is linker? As I said, linker is used to join together several object files into one large object file. Okay, and what is a loader? Loader is a system software which loads the machine code of the program into the system memory for execution. Okay, and debugger is a system software which helps to detect errors in the program. So then what is the purpose of system software actually? The purpose of the system software is to focus on problem solving. Okay, which helps us to create the application software. Okay, how the system software and the machine architectures are related? Okay, so that is the question. Okay, so the point goes like this: system software differs from application software in machine dependency. That means system software is strongly machine dependent. Okay, so most of the system software are machine dependent. Okay, that is one characteristics in which most system software differs from application software is the machine dependency. What do you mean by machine dependency? So most of the system software rely on the hardware, that means the computer architecture. Okay, so why, what is the reason? So reason is the system programs or system software are intended to support the operation and use of the computer itself rather than any particular application. Okay, so therefore A system software programmer must know the target machine architecture on which these system software runs. Okay, you need to know the target machine architecture. So when I say the target machine architecture, so machine architecture differs in what features? They differs in the machine code, the instruction set, the addressing modes, okay, the registers, data formats, okay, and so on. So for this reason, they are usually related to the architecture of the machine on which they run. Okay, so you can say that the system software are strongly machine dependent. So if you want to become a system software programmer, then you should know the target machine architecture on which the system software is running. Okay, you need to know its machine instruction format, instruction set, addressing modes they are using, okay, the number of registers, the number and type of the registers they are using, okay, memory, and so on. Okay. So example is assembler translates the mnemonic instructions to machine code, okay, and compilers must generate the machine code. So when designing the assemblers and compilers, okay, you need to have the knowledge of the target machine architecture also, okay, because they are directly concerned with the machine architecture. Then machine independent system software, okay, that is about the machine dependent system software. Okay, so which are the machine dependent software system software? The assemblers and compilers. Okay, and which are the machine independent system software? Okay, so there are aspects of system software that do not directly depend upon the type of the computing system. Okay, for example, the general design and logic of an assembler, general design and logic of a compiler, okay, code optimization techniques. Okay, so they are system software that do not directly depend upon the type of the computing system. Why? Because the general design and logic of the assemblers, the compilers, okay, the code optimization techniques, okay, will be same on most computers. Okay, the general design. Okay, so he's saying the general design of the assembler, compiler, okay, and the code optimization techniques is basically same on most of the computers. Okay, so therefore they are not directly concerned with the type of the computing system being used, or they does not depend upon the type of the computing system being supported. Okay. So that is how the system software and the machine architecture are related. So the relationship between the system software and the machine architecture. Next, coming to the differences between system software and application software. Okay, so first the application software. So application software focuses on the application or other problem to be solved using the computer system. Okay, so an application software focuses on using a computer as a tool to solve any problem. Okay, so that is the first point. And the second point is they are machine independent. Okay, so application software are machine independent. Okay, why they are called as a machine independent? Because they are not concerned about the architecture of the machine on which they run. Okay, so they are not concerned about the architecture of the machine on which they execute. Okay, and examples of application software: word processor like Microsoft Word, your Paint program, web browsers, okay, spreadsheets, okay, your DBMS, okay, they're all application software. So coming to the system software, so system software are written to support both the operation and use of the computer itself. Okay, and they are machine dependent. Okay, system software are machine dependent. So why? They are usually related to the architecture of the machine on which they are to run. And example of system software, operating system, assemblers, compilers, linkers, loaders, debuggers, and the text editor. So any doubts so far? Shall I continue?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Are you getting my points?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Now the next topic here will describe the architecture of the simplified instructional computer. Okay, so which is a hypothetical computer. Okay, so this is missing in our syllabus actually. Okay, so before taking into assemblers, no, you need to have knowledge of the simplified instructional computer architecture actually. Okay, so let us discuss the simplified instructional computer that are used as an example throughout the assemblers and loaders, linkers design. Okay. That means the author of the prescribed test book, the Leland Elbeck, so he has used this simplified instructional computer, okay, as a machine, okay, as a hypothetical machine to test the implementation of the various types of system software. Okay. So then what is SIC? Okay. So SIC stands for the simplified instructional computer. So why it is called as the hypothetical computer? It is a hypothetical computer. It is not a real machine. Okay, so it is a hypothetical computer that includes the hardware features most often found on real machines. That means you may ask why he has not used the real machine. Okay, so because real machines will have some unusual complexity. Okay. So we will find some unusual complexity on some real machines. So that is why he has used this hypothetical machine as a test bed to implement the various types of the system software. Okay. So this machine has been designed to illustrate the most commonly encountered hardware features and concepts. Okay. So it includes all the hardware features that are most often found on the real machines. Okay. While avoiding the unusual complexities that are often found on real machines. Okay. So it has avoided the unusual complexity that are often found on the real machines. Okay. So there are two versions of simplified instructional computer, the standard version and the extension version. Okay. So like as you know that any other products comes in some versions, no? Okay. So like SIC also comes into comes in two versions. Okay, standard model, it is called as simply SIC, extension version SIC bar XE. So there XE stands for the extra equipment model or the extra expensive. Okay. And note that these two versions have been designed to be upward compatible. So what I mean by that, these two versions have been designed to be upward compatible. Both are compatible, means that the object program for the standard model of SIC will also execute properly on a SIC bar XE system. So that is the meaning, okay, of the upward compatibility. Okay, that means if you write the program in the standard version, the version of SIC, no, then you'll be able to execute properly on the SIC bar XE also. That is possible, but reverse is not possible. Okay. So he has developed these two versions. That means he has made use of these two versions of SIC and SIC bar XE, okay, to illustrate the design and implementation of the various types of system software. Then you need to know the architecture of the simplified instructional computer. So SIC machine architecture. So here we will discuss the architecture of the simplified instructional computer with respect to the memory, registers, data formats, instruction formats, addressing modes, instruction set, and then input and output. So first, the memory. Okay. How memory is organized in the SIP machine architecture. Okay. So what do you mean by memory? So as you know that it is a storage device that stores program and data for use by the computer. Okay. And then what do you mean by the memory size or memory capacity? Anybody? What do you mean by the memory size or memory capacity? So memory size or memory capacity is about the maximum size of the required memory or the amount of information a computer can store in memory is the memory size or capacity. So I will repeat, the memory size or memory capacity is nothing but the amount of information a computer can store in memory is memory size or memory capacity, okay? Which is obviously quantized in terms of bytes, kilobytes, megabytes, isn't it? Gigabytes and so on, okay? Then how do you determine the size of the memory? How do you know the size of the memory? What is the factor that determines the maximum possible memory capacity of the system? Come on, you are already studied in microprocessor course. How do you find the maximum size of the memory?
It depends on the width of the address.
Yeah, good. Who is this?
Arun.
Arun, yeah. So the width of the address bus determines the maximum possible memory capacity of the system, okay? So another 10 minutes is that, yeah. So how the memory is organized in the SIP machine? Okay, so at the bottom you have the memory diagram, okay? So memory consists of 8-bit bytes. Okay, what do you mean by that? Okay, so at each location you can store one byte. Okay, so it is byte addressable. Okay, at each address there is a byte. Okay, and any three consecutive bytes form a word. Okay, so 3 bytes form a word, isn't it? So 3 bytes means how many bits? 24 bits. So 1 byte is 8-bit. Okay, so 8 into 3 is 24 bits. So any 3 consecutive bytes form a word. Okay. See here, any 3 consecutive bytes form a word. Okay. From the address 002, 0002, 0002. Okay. So what do you mean by that? Any 3 consecutive bytes form a word. It says the number of bits that the machine can process simultaneously. Okay, so this SIP machine architecture can process 8-bit or 24 bits of data at a time. Okay. Then there is a total of 32 kilobytes or 15 bytes in the computer memory. Okay. That means there are total of 32 kilobytes in memory address dash. So what is the address range? 0002 7FF. So what is the last address? If the total memory is 32,768, no? Okay, if the memory is having this 32,768 memory locations, no? Then obviously the address start from 0. And what is the ending address? The ending address will be 32,767. Okay, and it is usually expressed in hexadecimal, no? So what is the hexadecimal value of the address? 7FF. Okay. We start from zero address and then enter 7FF. Okay. So as I said, all addresses in simplified instructional computer are byte address. What do you mean by byte address? At each location, okay, at each location there is a byte. Okay. So that is the meaning of byte addressable or byte address. At each location there is a byte. So byte addressable refers to the architectures where data can be accessed 8 bits at a time. Okay, at each address there is a byte. Okay. But this simplified instruction computer can work on 24 bits at a time. But you can access only one byte at a time. Okay. So then coming to the registers. Okay. What do you mean by registers? You have studied in a microprocessor already. What are registers? Registers on the SICK machine architecture. Which are the register you have found in 8086 microprocessor? Anybody?
AX, BX.
Yeah. So similar to that, here also you have the registers. So registers are nothing but the fast storage locations in the CPU, which are temporarily used to store the instructions and data, isn't it? Okay. And this SICK machine has 5 registers. Okay. And what is the size of the registers? So each is 24 bits in length. Okay. That means, you can store 24 bits of data in each of these registers. That is the meaning. Okay. So 24 bits form a word. Okay. You can store a word in these registers. Okay. So this following table indicates the mnemonic of the register number. So these register numbers are used for reference only. Okay. Not for any processing. Okay. So they are used for reference only and their special use. Okay. So we have the register A, the mnemonic is A, okay, and number is register number is 0. Okay, what is the special use? Accumulator. So it is used as a accumulator. Okay, so what do you mean by accumulator? Accumulator is used to perform the arithmetic operations. Okay, so in 8086 microprocessor we have AX, no, okay, AX or AL. Okay, so like that. Okay. And next register is X, register X. So this is used as the index register. The register X is used as index register. So index register is used for addressing. Okay. Like in 8086 microprocessor, which are the registers used for addressing? We have used some registers for storing the offset addresses, no? Which are those registers? SI, DI, isn't it? Source index register, destination index registers, like that. Okay, so register X here can be used for the addressing. Okay, and we have the register L. Okay, stands for linkage register. Okay, so why do we need this register here? So the thing is, the simplified instructional computer does not have any stack. It does not use us any stack. Okay, so it uses the linkage register to store the return address. Okay, so as the name indicates. Okay. Linkage register stores the return address. Okay, so when this register stores the return address, whenever the jump instruction is executed, that means whenever you execute the JSON instruction, no, okay, so the linkage register stores the return address here. Okay, and then we have the next register as PC, stands for the program counter. Okay, so in 8086 also we have a PC. So what is the use of this program counter? Program counter contains the address of the next instruction to be fetched for execution. So PC contains the address of the next instruction. Then we have the status word, SW, register name is SW, status word. Like in 8086 microprocessor, you have the flags, no? Flag register, okay? Which contains some flag bits, okay? Which are the flag bits in 8086 microprocessor? Carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, and so on, isn't it? So this status word contain the variety of information, okay, including the condition code, okay, used for the testing. So it is similar to your flag register in 8086 microprocessor. Okay, so it contains the variety of information, including the condition code used for tests. So we have time. So another 1 minute, I think. Shall we stop here?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So one more class is there. What we'll do, because that is instruction class for CD and SS lab. Okay. Shall we start the lab instruction next week?
Yes.
Yeah, because we have to so I have to discuss among the course teachers the plans. Okay, so we'll come out with the plans, then it is better to have in the next week, I think. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so thank you for joining.
So is it
any doubts?
No, sir.
Yeah, yes. Okay, thank you then. Okay, so thank you all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.